Jesus.
Amen.
The victory in Jesus.
Amen.
Is all the plumbing done, brother?
I think so.
And then how much more do you have on your electrical roughing?
I'm good.
You're good? And they have already laid out like some mesh I've seen, and I think they'll be doing some more rebar this year, or is that it?
That's it.
And they're ready to pour. And so they'll be pouring this week. Do you know what day?
They're shooting for Tuesday for quarters and Wednesday for the slab.
Okay, so they'll be pouring the slab by Wednesday. It'll be all done. And then next step is erecting the building. So praise God for that. Amen. And just excited about that. I have a bit of news. Just want to, we're always finding new ways to raise money the Lord has presented with us. And y'all know that we're praying about Jehovah Jireh. And I won't give you the full specifics, but I will give you this answer to prayer. We were all praying about a recent financial windfall, and the church was approved to receive $19,700. And so we're excited about that. Praise God for that. That's not Jehovah Jireh. We still have that in July, so continue praying about that. Jehovah Jireh, they could possibly give us $50,000. And so that's all going towards the building project.
Amen.
So just be praying, but thank God for that. Amen. Amen. So God continues to show our church. I don't know how much more we need to know. And I say this to all the people on my daily encouragement every day, for those out there online. I say this, if you are not part of this work, you really ought to get involved, because God's hand is moving. on our church. And if you're here in the building, you look around, we don't have a lot of people, but you know what? God has made much out of our little church. Amen?
Amen.
And I believe that once we get our building, it will do what God will do what he needs to in the church.
Amen.
Consider growing it and all of that. And we have a lot of members that are just away due to COVID, and we have some that that I believe God will bring back to the church once we have our building. And I'm so thankful for Albuquerque Bible Church to always lend us their building, amen?
Yeah.
And they've just been a blessing to us, and really, really need to put something together very soon for their church, where we just serve their church. And I really think that we need to put that together, and if there's anybody who wants to head that up, please let me know. We will plan for that. We want to be a blessing to their church, amen? Pastor Palia has been a blessing to us, but this all belongs to the church, amen? The facilities, everything, and Pastor Paul has been so gracious with us and his wife, and we need to do something special for them also. And just, they're just amazing, amazing people. I'm just so thankful for them, amen? So those are all the announcements for the building project. I will be planning just a men's outing where we might get away to the lake. I'm shooting for either next Saturday or the Saturday after. I will be in contact with you guys to let you know if anybody's available. We want to just go have a good time with the men, just to get away. We usually do that yesterday, but things being the way they are, we're planning it for either next Saturday or the Saturday after. I will let you know, and we'll just get out and we'll go fishing. And this is for all the men, so ladies, I'm sorry. If you like to go fishing, you're going to have to go to the stores, whichever ones are open. Amen? Who likes going fishing, ladies? One. And the little girls, amen. And Leticia, she likes going fishing, amen. And so y'all are going to have to band together somehow so that we can have some time with the men, amen. And we look forward to that. And if things might change, because you know how it is. Well, we want to go too.
Right.
The next thing you know. But my wife's not going to go, so I don't think she doesn't like the lake. Do you like the lake, honey? She does not like the lake, so, and Erica doesn't like the lake. She ain't going, she'll get burnt out there, amen? And so, praise God. We'll talk more about it, but just be planning for that sometime soon, amen? All right. Does anybody have any prayer requests or blessings like to share with the church at this time, sister?
Pray for the Chavez family.
Right. Just got word on that. Pray for Sister Mercy, Brother Paul, and their whole family as they just lost their son. Continue praying for their son. We've been praying for Sister Mercy this entire time. And anything you can do to be a blessing, if you know her, go over there, go visit her, take her some food. This is not an easy thing. Let me say, I thank the Lord that I've never been through this, but a mother and a father who have lost their children before they've gone, it's a hard thing. Some of you in here have experienced that. And I just don't know how to deal with that other than just to go to God on it. Amen? And that's the best advice I can give. And so just pray for Sister Mercy, Brother Paul, and that. Amen? Anybody else prayer request blessing? We have a couple of new visitors. Praise God for that. Amen. We welcome you guys to the church. We're so thankful that the Lord, one of the brothers said the Holy Spirit brought him here. Amen. Praise God. Amen. And thankful for that. If the Holy Spirit don't know where you live, my father and I used to say, if the Holy Spirit don't know where you live, you in trouble. Amen? Because
yes.
He lives inside of you.
Right.
Amen. Praise God. Anybody else have a prayer request or blessing they want to share? Dad?
Yeah, it's just pray for my job. It's this week they shorten us with half an hour, and I don't know how it's going to go on in the future, so it might be less hours, but we're just praying that things will go back to normal.
Amen.
Amen.
Pray for my dad and his job. I must say, the Lord has blessed my dad, and that COVID has affected him, but not very greatly through the, even though the job, and I think that's been a blessing because it's helpful to him. You know, sometimes we need other perspectives in life, amen? And sometimes God has to force us into that perspective that we were not prepared to make. And we know that because we're here today when we were comfortable at a building for 7 years, and then God moved us out of there, amen? Anybody else, prayer request, blessing? Want to share with the church? All right, we're going to do something special for the men here in a second, but let me go ahead and get the ushers to come on up here, or the usher and Gabriel come help them to come on up here, and we're going to take the offering. Turn your Bibles to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20. It's a blessing to be with the fathers in the Lord's house. Amen.
Amen.
He's the ultimate father, the ultimate example of a father for us. And we really need to just always model that, model our life after him. And I'm so grateful for our God who's willing to give his only begotten son for our salvation. Amen. Acts chapter 20, verse number 35, the Bible says, I have showed you all things. So labor in God, support the weak, and remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Let me just tell you that the blessings are always in the giving. We really need to be have a giving heart. Make sure you give with a cheerful heart. Don't forget to continue giving your tithes, your offerings, but also we have the building fund missions. We're still taking care of our missionaries. Don't waver on those things that God has committed into your heart. Be faithful in that. Watch God bless you. Amen. Gabriel, pray for the offering, and then we'll get started.
Heavenly Father,
may
just bless the offering, and just give us giving hearts, Lord, that we enjoy the message, and that we have a great blessed Father's Day, Lord. And thank you for all you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Some of you guys do not fill up your cars with gas. So this is going to be the most gas you put in your car right here, $10.
It's a 34.
Are you excited? Did the new visitors, did you guys get one? Yeah, did you get one, brother? You get one? You want one?
It's okay.
You sure, brother? We can give you one.
No, it's okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Praise God. Amen. All right. Now, let me bring up Junior. Come up here. You got to pick one number.
Junior.
We're going to do one number, and then we will.
The letter G.
We're going to do one number.
Junior's too shy.
And then, here's what we're going to do. We're going to have worship music. We're going to have the preaching, and then we'll call out the winner. How will you guys stay here in the preaching? Amen.
You see if you can do number four.
So then it's fair, you got to do it in front of them. You're not Junior.
Junior,
too shy. You're funky, bro.
He's too shy,
huh? So just don't show them. Just pick out one. Pick one up. One number. Okay, give it to me. We're going to call it right now. You can go sit down, son. Okay. I didn't select a number, by the way. The lucky number, or like Brother McGee said, there's no such thing as luck because everything is God's will.
Amen.
The blessed number is number 6.
Yay.
You got number 6. Amen. Brother McGee, you got number 6.
No luck. No luck.
Brother. Is that a 9 or is that a 6?
It's curved. It's a 6.
It's a 9.
Brother Ryan said you had 2 numbers because you got 9. You just flip it over and say, I got 9. Congratulations. Sister McGee kept saying, I want that. And I said, you can't. You're not a father today, right? I said, you better pray for your husband to get it.
Yeah.
And so congratulations. And we just wanted to give one big gift today and then just a couple of just appreciation. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor.
Amen. Praise God for that. Let's let him have the worship team come up and do one song, and then we're going to get the message, and then we'll let you go for the rest of your day. Amen.
You could stand with us and you can sing along with him or just worship with us. Is to be with you.
Camel.
anybody?
Okay.
Honda Accord, Bible says the wise men all came in one accord. And here's a good one. This is my last one. Okay, ready? What kind of person was Boaz before he got married?
Single.
Ruthless. He was ruthless. Amen. Turn your Bible to Deuteronomy chapter 6. You guys are no fun. You guys are not very much.
Very old jokes.
Very old jokes. You guys did not laugh very much at these jokes. Amen.
No respect.
Praise God for that. We like to just lighten it up a little bit. Just have a good time. Amen. I want to get a little serious today. Not too serious, but I want to just help out the fathers. And I'm going to preach out of Deuteronomy chapter 6. I'm just going to preach a few verses. I'll try to be as quick as possible. The Bible says there in Deuteronomy chapter 6, you'll see it there on the screen if you don't have your Bible with you. The Bible says, "And these words which I commanded thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates." I want to preach on this subject, the influence of a godly dad, the influence. Godly Dad, let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the fathers that are here. God, I pray that the message would be helpful to them, that they would be able to utilize it in their life. And some have already been fathers for quite some time, Lord, and maybe they can teach their sons and their daughters, and they can just pass it on, Lord, and they can be that to their grandchildren, Father God. And I just pray that we would just use what you say in your word to help us live our lives, Lord. We thank you for the church and all the blessings you've given us already. Thank you for the Heavenly Father, who means more than anything, Lord. We're so grateful in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we join together today to celebrate Father's Day, I want to look at something today that can help you all out. Either you're a father or you're going to be one someday. Amen. And ladies, this is important for you also because it gives you information on what to look for concerning a husband. If you don't have a husband, you're going to be looking for a husband that is going to make a great father one day. Amen?
Yes.
These are some traits you want to see in life. Listen, if you are already married and you have a husband but you don't have any children, these are some things you're going to want to see your husband do. This is the person you're going to want to see him. So ladies, this can be helpful information to you and what to look at in a husband or a father one day. And it'll help you because let me tell you that fathers are a very important piece to the home. Can I get an amen? We live in a day where society brags about women being able to raise their own family by themselves. Now, I want to say this. We've seen that women are phenomenal in that they are able to do that job by themselves. They've done an excellent job of being able to provide for their kids. There's many women in a household without a father, they raise more than one child at one time, and they do good, and their kids come out great. But let me say that God never designed it for it to be that way. Amen? God didn't design it for it to be just a one-parent home, whether either direction. God never wanted it to be that way. God always meant it to be father and mother raising their children. Amen? And God made it so that women and men shared their responsibilities, and they each had a set of responsibilities that, let me tell you, they're not alike. The responsibilities of a mother is not the same as a father. Amen?
Amen?
The father will say, when your kid falls down the floor, the father will say, "Get up and shake it off, son." You know what he's teaching him? He's teaching him how to deal with the hardships of life, to get up and move on. A mother will go over there and dust his knee off and say, "You're going to be okay, mijito," and give him a hug. You know what she's teaching him? That there is love in the world that is needed. Amen? And so each role is different in a household when it comes to mothers and fathers. And the mother has a tremendous role in the family. But it's the father that brings the balance that's needed in a home.
Amen.
Yeah. Let me give you some statistics to show you the importance of a dad being in the home. Go ahead and put that up there, Demetrius. According to the U.S. Department of Justice, children from fatherless homes account for 63% of youth suicides for a household that does not have a father. Runaways are 90% of all homeless are runaway youths. Behavioral disorders, 85% of children that exhibit behavioral disorders come from a household that only has a mother in it. High school dropouts, 71% of all high school dropouts come from families that are fatherless. Juvenile detention rates are 70% of juveniles in the state operating institutions. Substance abuse, 75% of adolescent patients in substance abuse centers come from a fatherless home. And aggression, 75% of rapists motivated by displaced anger come from a fatherless home. When you look at those steps, that's pretty incredible, amen? And it's pretty obvious what the devil wants to do in our society, amongst our families in this world. See, the devil wants to displace families. It wants to be where it's a one-parent household, where the mothers are the only ones raising their kids, because the devil knows that God intended for a father to be there to make a difference in their children's life. Amen? And with that absent father in the household, let me tell you that all of this stuff happens, and this stuff creates society to be a lot less safer and not a good place, and not a good place for those children. Amen?
Amen.
So you get it now? Fathers are instrumental to the success of family and to the success of their children. But let me also say this. There are plenty of men out there who are in the homes with their families, but they are not fathers.
Yeah.
Yep. Amen. They're just playing the role, but they're not really the fathers they need to be.
Yeah.
They're just a person there, but they're not really the dads that can really shape their children. They're just there, and we need more men to stand up and be the dads that God called you to be. It doesn't matter your situation. God called you to be a father. You need to be that man that God called you to be. Amen. And by the way, we need not just dads to be dads, but we need dads to be godly dads. Amen. We need the fathers to be godly fathers. Why? Because we don't realize the effect we have on our children as dad. We don't realize that till later in life. Me and my wife were talking about how much we've influenced our children to this very point. To the 16 to 17 year old range, we talked about that yesterday, the things that she has done and the things that I have done. And let me just say this, it has not always been good.
Amen.
Some of the influences have been negative, and we ought to be careful about that.
Yes. Amen.
And we don't realize the effect that we have on our children as fathers. I'm telling you today that we need men to be godly men so that they can be a godly influence on their children. And why? And so that they can see great things happen with their children in their lives.
Amen.
Thankful for those fathers that take time out of their life to show their kids how much God means in their life.
Amen.
I want you to look at this verse again. Look at verse number 6 with me. And the Bible says there, "And these words which I have commanded thee this day shall be in thine heart." And so here's what God is telling the fathers, that if they're going to be any kind of godly influence on their children, here's what God's saying to them. They need to start by being influenced by God the Father first.
Yes,
you see, it's not a "let me tell you how to live, but I'm not going to live that life." That's not how it works in fatherhood, a godly father anyway.
Yes.
Amen. That's how it works in worldly fatherhood. It's a "do as I say, not as I do." Amen. It's "don't smoke that marijuana while they light a marijuana joint." It's "don't drink that bottle of beer or that shot of whiskey while they're taking shots themselves." It's "don't do those drugs while they're doing this." "Don't hit those women while they're smacking their wife." It's all of these things. It's a "do as I say, not as I do." But let me tell you, God wants godly fathers to follow him first so that they can be an example
Amen.
To their children.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
How do we be, how can we influence our children to be godly if we're not godly? Amen. When the Word says this, how are we going to do it? Well, the Word gives us an indication. The Word says there in verse number 6 that these words shall be in your heart. In other words, you're going to have to spend some time with the Lord.
Amen.
You're going to have to spend some time. A godly dad will be in the Word so much that it lives in your heart.
Amen.
That you wake up and it's there. You'll have Scripture memorized, and he will know what God wants, and he will know God's Word. And why is that important? Well, one day as a father, you're going to have your children come up to you for some advice.
Yeah. Yeah.
And what kind of advice are you going to give them if you're a godly father who has kept the Word in his heart? And God's Word will be the Word that you lean on for advice. It will be God's wisdom that you give your children, not your own wisdom.
Amen.
The Bible says, lean on unto thine own understanding, but in all ways acknowledge him, be shall direct thy path, right? Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. God says to put it, to give advice from his word, to give wisdom from his word.
Yes, amen.
And sometimes we give our advice, and it's not, it's fleshly advice.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. But a man of God, a godly father, will be in that word all the time. You know why? Because he wants to be able to tell Junior or his daughter, God said this, and this is how we should, but I don't understand it. Well, I don't agree with it. Yeah, but this is what God says.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
And if you're a godly father who's kept God's word, then you'll lean on that. Godly father won't hesitate to let their children know what God's word says about their life. You know, son, your life is not where it should be. And let me just say this. And I'm not talking about in a demeaning manner. You're not successful like you should be. No, I'm saying, when you see your son doing the wrong things of life and you've trained him the right way, you know what? You should be able to tell your son what God says about their life.
Amen.
You're not living the life that you should be. You know better.
Amen.
I've taught you better. God has taught you. You've been in it. You've seen it. You know that this way only leads to destruction. You know that continuing to do that will lead you in a life of ruin, and you'll just be in so disheartened, so much despair. You're not gonna be able to get back. You need to get out of that now.
Yes.
And a godly father will hesitate to tell their children about that. He will know how to comfort their children with good words of the Lord, and he'll also know when to admonish them. You know when your child's heart is broken? And you can just go up to him with the word of God and give him some comfort there.
Amen.
And the godly father will use God's word to influence their children for good. But here's the key. They have to be influenced first. The father has to be influenced by God first. The word says in Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, you can see it up there on the screen, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Does this mean that they will be perfect when they get older? That's not what it means. No, it means this. It means that if you have given them from God's word, it will stick.
Amen.
And one day, it will manifest itself in their life. Like the moment that they're struggling. And you'll pray for them. You'll say, you know what? I taught them right. And I trained them up in the way of the Lord. And now that they're older, they'll come back. Why? Because my God's word does not return void.
That's right.
My God doesn't make promises that he don't keep. My God is not a liar.
That's right. Amen.
And they're not going to be perfect. Don't be so hard on your children. Hey, listen, you were once one.
Amen.
And you were not perfect.
Yes.
Praise God that your kids are saved, hopefully.
Amen.
Praise God you're saved. Praise God that you have a godly, that you're a Christian mother and father. Some people, they grow up with Christian parents.
Yeah.
I look at my wife, and she grew up with her dad and her mom. Her dad's a pastor all her life. She knew nothing but Christianity. Amen. I didn't grow up that way. I'm thankful my mom and dad are saved to this day. I'm glad that they've chosen Christ and they serve God. I didn't live such a horrible existence, but let me tell you something. We didn't have a Christian home the way that we know it today.
Amen.
And it makes a difference. But I'm thankful that my kids will never know that other home.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
You say, your kids are perfect. No, they're not perfect.
Amen.
But if you train them right, when they mess up, they'll come back.
Yes.
Amen. A godly father's influence shows their children the importance of serving an almighty God. How? He reminds them consistently. Look at verse number 7. The Bible says, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by thy way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. So the word here says that thou shalt teach them diligently. The word diligently means this, with steady application and care, consistently teaching your kids. Don't waver on the word of God. Don't waver on being a godly parent. Don't waver on your service to God. Listen, ladies, this can apply for you too. Because oftentimes kids waver when they see their parents waver. Amen?
Yes.
It's when they see their parents come to church and praise God and then go home and blaspheme the Lord. It's when they see their parents come and say, hallelujah, that was great. And then on the way home, they're talking about preacher. Come on. Amen. Nobody really amen that one. Amen.
Amen.
No, give themselves away. Don't worry. I love you guys anyway. Amen. Teach them diligently. Steady application, but not only steady application, with care. We should have great care in teaching our children about God. Why? Because if we're not careful, listen to this, church, we can hurt them with the idea of who God really is.
Yes.
You see, there are many times that you have told your children, or you will tell your children, to have faith, to search Scripture, to seek God in that, to ask God to comfort you. And you will then get into a bind yourself. And you know what you'll do? You'll lose faith. You won't pick up the Bible. You won't seek God. You won't trust Him.
Amen.
And they look at you and they go, but I thought you said, take care of how you teach them about the Lord. Because you can influence them to say, you know what, my mom and dad always said trust the Lord, but they don't trust them, so you know what, God's not trustworthy. Take care of how you teach your children about God. Remind them always. Godly fathers seek to remind their children at every moment. Hey, have you done your devotions? Hey, have you been in your Bible? Hey, do you know what the Word of God says here? Hey, we need to go to church. Hey, we need to be serving God always. Hey, you better tell your friends about Jesus. Hey, you're always reminding them. Why? Because that's what godly influence does. A godly father. And when they are sitting and where they are walking together or whatever they're doing before you go to sleep, before you wake up, the Bible says you should constantly be telling them about the Lord. Giving them the Word. Be a godly influence to your children. A godly father's influence will display his own life. Look at verse number 8. And the Bible says, and thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thy hand, and thou shalt be as frontlets between thy eyes. In those days, they would memorize Scripture, and they would get Scripture, and they would put them on their wrists. They would bind them on their wrists. And you know what else they would do? They would get them, and they would put them on their forehead, and a little box, it would sit in a little box right here between their eyes. It almost looked like they had a GoPro strapped to their forehead. Have you ever seen those? And they would walk around with that all day long, trying to memorize Scripture. Let me tell you, they would put Scripture on the wrists and their forehead. Why? To serve as a reminder of His Word. You know, oftentimes as men, we get so distracted with this world and we forget about God's Word.
Yeah.
We go, you know what we do, men? Oh, we're all guilty, including your pastor, because I work a full-time job. We know how exactly to separate 8 hours of our life for this world and for the company we work for. To the point where we're not going to be distracted. But we have a hard time separating any time for the Lord. And you know, these things binding on the wrist and the head was a reminder all day long when they were working, when they were doing something, that they still had to put God first. They still had the Word of God. They needed a reminder. And it served them as a reminder of His Word. But let me tell you what else happened in this. The children would see this and be reminded about how much their dad loves the Lord. They would see their dad walking around, and I'm sure someone would probably make fun of their dad behind the scenes. Amen. Look at my dad. He's got all that Bible on him. Amen. But the children would be reminded about how much their dad loves the Lord. And they saw their dad was not only going to tell them about God, but he would also live it out by binding it to his hands and binding it to his forehead. This is an image of a godly father. Why? Because it is obvious and it shows in their life. Listen, dads, I'm not telling you to get Scripture and tape it to your forehead like this or your hands. What I'm saying is this. How often do your children see dads seriousness with God? How often do your children see you in the Word day and night, meditating on God's Word? Just so much that it lives off of you that, hey, it's evident when they look at God, they know that God lives in them. They know that God's the one for them. They know they serve God and God only.
Amen.
To the point that it would be like having something attached to your forehead and your wrist. That's what your kids see of you, or do they see something else?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
How many times do they see you praying? How many times do they see you studying? How many hours can they say this about you? My dad lives for God and loves God, and he has a godly life because I can see it all over him.
Amen.
How many times? I see how he reads scripture, how he memorizes it. I see how he treats my mom because he's in the Word of God all the time. I see how he treats people around him. He never has attitude. He's loving, kind, and caring. I see my dad witnessing the people that are lost and helping others. Why? Because God is so obvious to them that they see it as if you were wearing scriptures on your hands and on your head. Man, we got to do that, man. We really got to show our children. Listen, the last thing the godly father will do to influence is he will make God the center of his home. Look at verse number 9. The Bible says there, and thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and of thy gates. You see, a godly father will make sure his home is a house of the Lord. In other words, others will come to his home and they will know that that's where you serve God. It's one thing to be spiritual in church, but let me say this. It's one thing to be spiritual in church, but if I were to go to your home and open your fridge and look through your house, what would I find? It's easy to leave the skeletons in the closet at home.
Yeah.
Amen. Well, let me tell you that God doesn't have to look. He can already see you.
Yeah.
He doesn't have to go searching. He sees it all.
Yes.
And a godly father will make his home a godly home. He will not allow the filth of the world to infiltrate the house. Why? Because he has children that will one day be adults. He will not tolerate sin in his home. You see, a godly father will have his home respected as a place where God is welcomed.
Yeah.
I told you the story many times before when I first got saved, and my mom had a party. We had visited from California. And my brother had brought over some alcohol. He wasn't saved at that time. I didn't want my kids around alcohol. I got saved from that stuff. I got away from that life. I didn't want that life anymore. Amen. God rescued me from that garbage. And he brought over alcohol. And you know what I told my mom? I said, you know what, Mom? I love you, Mom, but I can't have my kids around that. Like, I'm teaching them differently. I said, we have to leave. She says, why are you going? I told her why. And then she said, I said, you know, and my brother at the time, he didn't want to get rid of it. He wasn't saved. Praise God, he saved today. Amen. And he doesn't do that now. And so my mom went ahead and declared a little announcement to the rest of the family because she loves her children. I believe that. And here's what she declared to the family. She said, from now on, there will be no alcohol allowed at any of our parties, our family parties, period. If you don't want to abide by that, don't come. I felt a little special because, you know, and my sister and her kids and her husband, they didn't drink. You know, and I was happy about that. You know why? Because she said in that moment, her and my dad decided we're going to be a house that does not welcome the stuff that God wouldn't welcome.
Amen.
You got to be careful. I'm not telling you to condemn those people in your family that don't do wrong. Witness to them. You love on them.
Yes.
We have plenty of lost people in our family. We love them. We'll invite them over. We will welcome them in with open arms. Amen. But you, as a godly father, have a right to say, this is what I allow in my house, and this
yes.
is what I won't allow in my house. Because God means more to me than anything else. Amen. Make your home a place that God is welcomed and respected. Here's my statement. We're already almost done. Here's my statement. Put it up there, Demetrius. Statement is by D.L. Moody, if you don't know who he is, godly man, preacher. Here's my statement. A man ought to live so that everybody knows he is a Christian, and most of all, his family ought to know.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
They say, you know what that means? That a godly father's influence will always start with our walk in our life. And what that means is this. That means that what they see at home must reflect what they see in the church. You know why a lot of preachers' kids go away from God? Let me tell you why. Because they see their preacher, dad, preach the word of God, and then go home and live like a lost man.
Yeah.
Amen.
I'm so grateful when she's been there to be able to say, hey, listen, we can't do that. Or we need to do this. And remind me, because you know what? I don't want my kids to run from the church because their daddy didn't live a godly life that he preached.
Yeah.
And some of you, you might want your kids to be godly in the sense, and let me tell you something, just live that godliness before them. Be that example. They ought to know that you're a Christian. Godly fathers will always influence their children, and it starts off with our life, for it is the life that they look at and how that it gives them an example of how to be a godly influence. But let me tell you something, it is also the thing that causes them to go away when we live a life of double standard. Amen? Be consistent. Be diligent. Be a godly example. Watch your children be influenced for the most important Father, God. Women, you can use this sermon for your life too, because listen, it applies to godly mothers too. You're going to, mothers, you spend more time with your kids than fathers do most of the time. Amen. Even if you're working, you spend more time because the father is just always trying to be busy about something. Amen. Or watching sports. There's none now, so fathers have plenty of time to be fathers. Amen. Be a godly example for your kids. Raise your children. Raise your grandchildren with a godly example. One day they're going to have kids, and how are they going to treat their kids? I'll tell you what. The way to know, my father-in-law used to say, the way to know that if you've been a successful parent is not how your kids turn out, but it's how their grandchildren turn out, how their children turn out.
Yep.
If my son has some good godly kids, and I know I did my job,
because
I passed it down. Amen? And if he has wrong kids, well, then that's his fault. Just kidding, son. Amen? He's going to have great kids. Amen? All right, let's stand. Every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around. I just want to give the fathers some time today. The men time today. Whether you're a father or not, why don't you come forward and examine your life? Are you living godly for the Lord? As the worship music is played, are you living for the Lord like you should? Are you being the godly influence? Are you exhibiting your life as a life of that the Lord is written all over it? Is your house a home of the Lord? Do you have scripture in your heart? Has God influenced you first? You're the head of the household. As the music's played, maybe you're out there, maybe God spoke to you in a different way with this message. Maybe God's just tugging on you personally to live a godly life. Whether father or mother, maybe God's saying to you, hey, listen, you need to clean up some things in your life. You need to get some things right in your life. Come forward and give it to the Lord. Praise God, if you're here today, you're not saved. You don't know Christ, your personal Savior. Maybe God's asking you to do that right now.
The altar. blood of Jesus Christ, oh come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Thank you for coming today. Happy Father's Day to all you fathers. Make sure you spend time with your kids or your dads. Amen. If you're not a father, spend time with your father. Praise God. Thank you for watching online. I hope you have an incredible day. We will see you all online.